red wine from Provence, which ones to choose? The best, of course. So, first I have to tell you that Provence is usually a place where the wines are not from one vine, but are a blend of two, three, four, sometimes five different vines. And it's an obligation for them to be able to have the AOC, what we call AOC. Do you know what it means? Controlled Origin Appellation, COA. It should be in England. So it's a must. You have when you want to have the highest level for the wine, for the labels, you have to respect the yields, the vines, and the combination of the vines. So all the people try to do the best. They will tell you, my wine is the best. Of course, they try. It's just like when you have children. You say, my children is the best. And no one is has a better education than him. But in fact, it's just like children. Sometimes parents are nice, but children, oh. Well, I have children. I know what I'm talking about. And I think that probably I've spoken too much, and we gonna have a first drink so that you can already be in the mood with the red wine. So the first one we're gonna taste is wine from the Chateau Lacoste, which is in Côte d'Aix appellation. It's in the Puy Saint-Éparade. And why did I choose this wine? Because first, it's absolutely typical of a wine from what I call entrée de gamme. Entrée de gamme means the first wine people achieve. So it's always a very good sign for the rest of the quality. When you have, it's just like in Burgundy or in Bordeaux, the lowest appellation people have. You have a very good idea of what people can achieve for the best. It's always a very good sign. When you taste the lowest cuvée, it gives you an idea of what you can find in the label. So, I told you that the wine from Provence, the red wine, which has a white or the rosé, are blends. This one is a blend of three grapes. You have 40% of Grenache. Grenache is a vine that gives big fruit. They have 30% of Syrah and 30% of Cabernet Sauvignon. I stop speaking. One. Very silent, but I know after two or three glasses, usually people speak a little more. Côte d'Aix.
Okay. What temperature do you drink red wine in from Provence?
Never cold.
Never cold?
No, never cold, because when you have red wines which are cold with some grapes, it gives a it can give a harsh profile, you know. Burgundy, this is a perfect temperature for Burgundy, but for the other 20 is very nice.
Is it?
Yes.
Okay.
If you drink them at 16, 17, probably not a wine like this, but other wines which are, especially when you have a Syrah or Cabernet Sauvignon, they are so very structured that the temperature, the coolness, makes them a little harsh, a bit austere.
Okay.
They have to have more degrees.
Yeah.
So this is a good approach for a wine. It's a bit special because this wine has to breathe. It smells a little like sulfur. In fact, it's what we call reduction. It's a technical word to say that the wine is rather compact, and needs to have some oxygen to give everything. So it smells a bit like sulfur, but it has nothing to see with sulfur. It's just the smell that is a bit equivalent. It's not the default. It's just that the wine is saying, open me, wait for me some minutes, so that and turn me in the glass, and after 2 or 3 minutes you won't feel it, because the wine breathes. Coming from everywhere, so that everybody could see the difference between the Provence wine, hello sir, and the wine from other parts.
Yep.
But I chose that you would only drink very good wine tonight.
Could you explain again what you meant by the importance of the cuvée at the beginning?
The cuvée?
Yes.
A cuvée is, it's a name for, imagine you have a tank, and you say this is the wine that will be bottled in this one, and it's called this cuvée. This is the cuvée for this bottle, and it's a special name. That's what we call a cuvée.
And you said that the first cuvée
was alright.
Could you just explain that?
You mean when I spoke about the lowest cuvée?
Yeah.
Yes. For instance, when people pick the grapes, they know they have very good places, good places, medium places, and some are rather bad, or the vines are young, and so on. So they know that they don't have the same liquid in the tanks. And they decide that this will be for the great wine, this and this and this for the medium wine, and this the other one for the lowest cuvée, let's say. And that's what I meant. Yeah, because all the winemakers, all the chateaux have different plots, and they know they are not all the same quality.
I can't find any red wine in the world that I think can be drunk above 18 degrees.
In the Rhone?
Now, in my point of view, I think so, but this is very subjective, of course. But okay, if you say so.
Well, in the southern part of Rhone, the wines are mostly based, made from Grenache, and Grenache can be drank rather cool.
Yeah.
That's the exception. But if you drink the wine from the Rhone Valley, from the northern part, it's 100% Syrah, and you will have great deception, because it's, that's harsh, it's not good. Well, no,
okay.
It's very good, but it's just the grapes that changes.
Of course.
With the heat, you feel a little more of the alcohol in the wine.
Yeah,
it changes the perception. Mm.
That's my issue around it.
Yeah.
What do you think is the temperature of this wine?
I think here now you have 23 degrees.
Mm. Definitely.
Yes, yeah. We have 23. Yeah, today. Whoa. It's such a hot day. Whoa. Yeah. Yeah. So, we can't change the weather, unfortunately. Because rosé now represents 85% of the bottling of production. 12.5% for the reds, and 2.5% for the whites. So you can see that it's. But for the people in France, I mean, the wine is the great wine is a red wine. So all the producers try to make a very good red, because in France, that's what these are the wines we are judged about. So, it's cultural.
Mm-hmm.
That's a part of our genetic.
C'est comme ça.
Yeah, okay. So we're going to taste something else now. Which is disorder? Yes. Oops. Château Fontainebleau. Château Fontainebleau, that you know, is not far from here. And this one is 50%. Cabernet Sauvignon. 30% Grenache and 20% Syrah. But the vinification is not harsh. It's rather soft. So this wine, they have different cuvées, but this wine is pleasant, you know. It's a wine that can be drank rather easily. Mm. And it's a good thing that, because with 50% Cabernet Sauvignon, you could have very structured wine, hard to appreciate when young. But you see, that is not the case.
Has it been in oak barrels?
No. In this one, they don't they don't put in barrels, just tanks.
Funny.
Is your deep drinking?
In fact,
you are starting to enjoy this.
They told me yesterday.
It's a little sad to say it, but Provence has no great terroir. A good terroir, but not exceptional terroir. Well, some say yes, my lads, exceptional. We have microclimates, which are absolutely lovely. And we can achieve incredible wine. Yes, they can say it, but I don't think it's true. If Provence had exceptional terroir, we would know it. There are some nice plots, but I think the intelligence in Provence is to moderate everybody was served. The intelligence in Provence is to be able to conciliate the earth, what is in the earth, the good vines, and, well, intelligent culture. Because you can't expect the soil to give more than it can give. So, if the soil is good, well, not exceptional, it will change the wine, you know? And so, the big thing in Provence is that you have wine very well made, and some special grapes on certain plots which give the best, but you will never have something exceptional that makes you have scatter, you know, and mind-blowing. Nothing is mind-blowing in Provence. I'm sorry to say that, but it's just to explain you that the work of the winemakers is to achieve the best they can, but don't expect in Provence to have absolutely exceptional things. It's never.
I tasted the other day, do you remember? It was not blend, it was only
Cabernet Sauvignon.
Yes,
that's right.
Provence is not a soil for Cabernet Sauvignon.
No, I'm sure.
But it can be very good. You will taste one with Cabernet Sauvignon, but I think that, you know, when you see the history of Provence, Provence was a poor vineyard with very poor quality in the 80s. And it started to increase at this time. And so some people say, yes, we must do good things and so on, there's a market, blah, blah, blah. Well, these were very good things. But so they tried to copy what was for them the best. And for them, the best at this period was Bordeaux. Because Bordeaux had a very powerful market, they make good business. And so they said, we're going to plant Cabernet Sauvignon. We have the soils that can support it. And it can mature here, so we're going to make it. And many people planted Cabernet Sauvignon, such as many people planted for the white wine, Roll, which is a very good grape, but it's not. It will never be exceptional.
No, but
never.
It's good. It's okay.
But good is very. It's very interesting.
Yeah.
And so, but it's difficult for Provence to be able to achieve a really interesting wine from Cabernet Sauvignon. But I'm glad Mr. Dyson could do it.
You should try it.
Yeah.
Just the tips.
Yeah.
So.
Oh yes, of course.
Yeah.
But and that is.
I'll happening. Bring you one bottle tomorrow. You can take.
Yeah, that is how it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can take one too.
He bought burgundies from me during years.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah.
White burgundies.
Yeah, that's good.
So, what do you think of that?
Light and good.
Yeah. So easy approach.
Yeah.
And very interesting for that. So this, they didn't fall in the trap that could consist in pressuring too much and vinification with tannins. That you know you have to wait a while for 5-6 years and then lose the freshness. What you call in French la fraîcheur. La fraîcheur is something that you will often hear about it. When people, the winemakers speak about the fraîcheur, it means that the wine can be very rich, but they have punch. You know, they're still blossoming in your mouth. And this is the fraîcheur. They're not flabby, you know. They have an urge that gives you a very good profile and make the wine very attractive. This is la fraîcheur. Always something that has to do with acidity and the balance. In fact, it's 100% Sanso. This is very special because Sanso is a grape with which we used to make rosé wine. Most of the wines, the rosé wines, are made from Sanso and Grenache. And most of them, yes, you say 50-50 Sanso Grenache or 60-40. And it's very good because the Sanso gives the finesse of the food, but doesn't give the body for a wine. So it's always vinified with to achieve rosé wine. But in some cases, just like this, and you see another one later on, these are all vines of Sanso. And the man, a very talented winemaker, decided that he would make just a cuvée of pure Sanso. So it gives a finesse to the wine, and well, let's not talk about it. Taste it, it's better. 100% Sanso, because you know that the wines have to be a blend. So he put a grape of I don't know what. And
does it have to? Sorry to interrupt, but does it really have to be a blend?
Yeah.
You can't actually choose to have only one grape.
No.
But then Mr. Dyson has done something wrong. Then.
Or you're not allowed to, you can be IGP, and the Indication Géographique Protégée. IGP you can call it. But you can't be Côte de Provence if you are just one grape.
Okay, yeah, I see.
Well, so the subtleties is of the French laws, you know.
And you're not allowed to have more than 3 suppliers, right? For Côte
de Which area was this wine from?
Sanso, pure Sanso.
Is it pure Sanso?
And one grape of Grenache or four, I don't know what. Well, in fact, no, they said there was something else.
but from where is this?
Carnoul. They respect the soil, everything, they don't put pesticides.
This is from the man up
And
here.
So that's why they chose this as a. You know it,
the moose
from Norway.
Yeah, the moose.
Because it's for them the sign of the purity.
Here are the pure sitting behind the fence.
The prisoners.
The prisoners sitting behind the fence.
Can you spell me Sanso?
C-I-N-S-A-U-L-T. And the, well, Sanso. No meaning. Well, but it's a joke. But the real name, Sanso, is great. It's put something out from the wine and something that fits the wine and gives beauty expressive. And when you filter, You lower the wine, but you have to make it. For instance, when you've got great export markets, because people, if they see the wine is a bit, is not absolutely bright, perfectly bright, they say, "Oh, this wine has a problem." No, it's not filtered. It can have some things inside. It's just natural.
Very fruity.
Yeah, lovely nose, flowery nose.
Very good bouquet.
Very, very good, yes.
It's sort of sweet.
Mm. Yeah, you think it's sweet.
Yeah, I can see.
Yeah, it's a fruitiness. It's
because of fruit is.
And before Vidal says it, I agree with him. It should be better with 3 degrees less.
Yeah.
You can take it with your hand if you want.
Yeah,
Oh, you're lovely.
Watch that corner.
So this is a different expression, you know? You see that it's more elegant, I would say, than the two others, which are based from Cabernet and Syrah. This one is just the finesse that expresses. And, it's very special, and it's rare to find something like this in Provence. It's just
more to do service with.
Any meat would fit, I'm sure. And with charcuterie it would be good. And of course, all the poultries. Yes, no doubt.
Poultry's good. Now, perhaps foie gras. No, foie gras.
Goose liver.
No,
talking about duck breast.
Duck breast.
Magret.
Too light. Too light.
It's a bit too light. Yeah. Yes. For magret. Yeah. Magret is very. The flesh is very.
Okay.
You have to have a wine in the same style. Something. So, in fact, he lied. He said it was 99.9 and 0.1 of I don't know what he invented. And this is another originality. This one, it's just just to discover what can be done. It's a wine made from Merlot, 100% Merlot. And Merlot is a grape that you can find on the right bank of Bordeaux, and also in some parts of Rhone Valley. It's a grape that gives very rich wines, you know, very impressive. When you drink a young Merlot, you have so much in the mouth, and it's round and it's fleshy, it's fruity, it's lovely when it's very well made. But the way it evolves in the time is not very, very interesting all the time. You have to have a great terroir so that it expresses magnificently, such as Chateau Petrus is 100% Merlot.
Okay.
Yeah. But it's a special soil. So, I'm speaking, but I'm the only one to have. This is very special. And this is not Côte de Provence, it's IGP, Indication Géographique Protégée, Protected Geographic Indication. So it means that they can't have the COA, and it's a IGP, so it's a kind of distinction, but it's not the highest because it's 100% Merlot. Just this, and they made half Merlot and half Cabernet would be called well, Cotobawa, this area.
Why would a winemaker choose to do that? For, you know, a sense of adventure, or is it cheaper, or the taxes, or?
I don't know, just because he thinks it's good, he loves the Merlot, yeah. And he wants to make something with Merlot, and he thinks that the soil is good with Merlot at this
point.
And well, I don't know exactly. But it can be many things, but I don't think the money is the reason, because it's not good for them to make Merlot here. You know, it's more it's good that they are doing good.
Yeah.
It's quite nice.
Well.
I like this.
What kind of fruit do you taste?
Melon.
This is an example.
I think the sole up there from the valley.
It's not really
against
interesting.
Against
Bocholt. Yeah. It's not the one I sell. I have added it to the tasting. I said you have 9 wines and this is a 10th. I've added it because I said, well, why not taste it today? But So let's change and try something better. You agree?
We go to something better.
Think about Australia or
something. Yeah, it's not interesting. Just to show you that.
Wow, Herbert.
Well, this is not the one I sell. It's just one I wanted to say so that you can see that. And I suspected it to be rather powerful, and it was the case, so that's why I didn't want to serve the procure the other one. This one after could have been that felt a little weak. So, let's try as well now. Yes. It's an additional bottle. It's not a part of the 9 I wanted to make you taste. It's the 10th bottle. So
it's good to throw in a curveball.
but it's interesting. Tambov was the ancient owner of Chateau Miraval, and when he sold Miraval, he bought Mascaron and created another vineyard in Fox-en-Fou.
So this is in
Fox-en-Fou, Mascaron? No, this one is from Le Luc en Provence.
Le Luc.
It's next to Domaine de la Bernarde, which was a very, very good domain before.
Yes.
In the ancient time, I would say. And unfortunately, la Bernarde decreased. And so this is
a
blend mainly based upon Syrah, 75% Syrah, and maybe 80, between 75 and 80, and the rest is Cabernet Sauvignon. But so you've got a dominance of Syrah, so it means the wine is rather powerful, a bit spicy. You know, this goes a little in oak, but not new oak. But in oak, so that it gives a different profile. But I like it because it's so well made. That's absolutely one of the very good domain in Provence. And this is the kind of wine that ages very well. I sold last year vintage 05, which was, oh my goodness, so good. And I also sold the vintage 11. Cabernet Sauvignon was planted a lot in the 80s and in the 90s. Moreover, at this time, there are not a lot of domains who bottled their wines, and so they sold what we call en vrac to negotiators. And there were vine grapes that was that were paid much more than the other. So everybody planted. But everybody planted even on places that shouldn't have been planted, Cabernet Sauvignon. Mm-hmm. And now we've got the, between commas, the fruit of this, because the vine is always a very long time period, and the, just like architecture, the errors you make, you see them 20 years after. And now we all see that, most of the domain have Cabernet Sauvignon that give powerful wine, not soft, not round, it's not soils which are that adapted to this grape. And Provence is, well, the problem is there in Provence. Too many wines are from Cabernet Sauvignon, which is not a good grape for this for the soil. But except in Ravel or Rabel. Rabel is exceptional. But I will know that tomorrow.
Yes.
He said he would give me a bottle.
Yeah, I'll bring it to
you. Tell the hour you come and we we say all the people that we drink together.
I'll bring it to you.
Yeah. And no, I'm joking, but I'm very interested, you know?
Yeah, yes. I'm looking very forward to hearing everything. What you think.
Now we are going to taste bottle number 6 is Miraval. The new cuvée from Miraval.
Ah, a new cuvée.
Yes.
What is it called this year? What is it?
No name.
Really? Okay.
Miraval.
My name is Nobody. That's a film also.
you should make a film with this. So, since vintage 2012, the Domaine de Miraval has changed. I mean, it's not the same team that vinifies. The new owners have asked Mr. Perrin, Marc Perrin, who is the owner with his brothers of Château de Beaucastel in Châteauneuf-du-Pape, which is one of the greatest domains in the Rhône Valley and one of the stars of Châteauneuf-du-Pape, to take in charge the winemaking, the culture, and so on. And so they decided to change some little things, and the main change comes now with the red, because they are incredible winemakers for the red wines. Mm-hmm. Their Châteauneuf are so famous and justified. And so Marc Perrin went into the domain, and he told me that he has seen some very special plots which were really, really interesting. And I think in some years there will be a special cuvée issued from certain plots. Just like there was Natushka before, but Natushka was 100% Syrah, 100% New York. Well, it's maybe a caricatural. But they have decided that some plots will make part of an incredible cuvée. And they also decided that they would change the assemblage, the blend, for the red Miraval. The Miraval red was before a combination of 60% Syrah and 40% Cabernet Sauvignon. But as I told you, Cabernet Sauvignon, it was rather good there because it's good at equation, but they want to achieve something better. And so for this cuvée, now as they decided they would not put any Cabernet Sauvignon in. It's a main change. Mm-hmm. It's 50% Syrah, 30%, 35 Grenache, and 15 Cinsault. You know the Cinsault we have, so for the finesse. Mm. And you see the difference in style, because this wine is full-bodied, but in the same time, the tannins are very round, very smooth. And that's a sign of the immense talent of winemaking.
What's the price for this wine now?
Well, I I sell it 21.
Mm. Yeah. It's a very good wine.
But why this new bottle?
Well, they chose that since vintage 12, they would put the wine in this new bottle.
It's no more playback.
It's not called playback anymore. No. And it's not the same combination.
No, I understand that. Yeah. But that is behind. So now it will be only which is the red one.
No, yes. It's payback.
So rich, the material of the wine is incredibly rich, and the wine is incredibly round.
And you can feel it afterwards. That's a good thing. You can actually taste it for some time.
Yes.
It's not finished.
So length is lovely, yes. Yeah.
But this is made in 2014 or?
13.
And what? This wine is
13.
13. It's 13. Yeah. It's just been released.
Mm-hmm. Millesim?
Can you keep it for a few years? No?
Yeah, yes, it can age.
It's called millesim.
Millesim means vintage.
Millesim from the ground.
Yes, of course. It will. You can smell some truffle. That is good.
You
don't take any risk if you wait 2, 3, 4 years. It has a structure too. Now that you've seen what the new team has done, you're going to see what the old team has done too. They're back.
Yeah.
It's one of the wines that can age rather easily. And it's very interesting, all the red wine from Miraval, a little like the white, are very good between 5 and 10, 12 years. So that's a sign of the ancient winemaking, but very interesting. The smell, the nose, is quite on the Cabernet. It's typical from a Cabernet Sauvignon which has evolved. The nose is a bit like Bordeaux. It tastes smell blind, Bordeaux, because it's oaky, and it's a Cabernet. That's what you smell. But it's not a default, you know? It's good when it is its quality. So the wine is round in the mouth, just like the other one. But had you tasted this one when it was 2 years old, you wouldn't have the pleasure you had with this one. No, it was a bit... you had to wait, it was good, but tannic. And now, both combined make quite a different wine.
Incredible. This one's already 7 years old. Amazing.
And it's strange because, I don't know if you feel the same thing for me, but for this one, the temperature is, it would be better, it's less... it's less a problem than for the other.
Yeah.
I think, that influence of the Cabernet when it's very well made, the heat can be higher without compromising the impression. Mm-hmm. They come both. And we're going to take the other domain that he made. And this is a cuvée of pure Syrah, 100% Syrah. Mm-hmm. Young vines, and you see, it's completely different in style. And
what is the name of that wine?
It's a domaine Beaumont de Cormeil. They make very few, and it's just sold in big restaurants and some people like it.
Some people.
I have had an incredible experience with that wine. I'm going to tell you when you've tasted it. It was the first wine they made because they planted, and you know you have to wait for the third leaf before you can make a wine. So the vine has to be 4 years old, not before. So it's a wine made from very, very young vines. It can't be younger than this, mm-hmm. but you can feel the impression, the structure. It's incredible.
Mm-hmm. But they don't longer sell it.
Sorry?
They don't longer sell it there?
No, they don't sell it. I mean, they have no structure to sell. They sell it to some restaurant.
Do you sell it here?
What?
Do you sell it here?
Yeah.
What is the price of it?
It's not expensive. It's 16, I think.
Okay.
Yeah. It's pure Syrah. It's been opened this afternoon around 3 o'clock.
Will you have decanted or no?
Will he hold harder?
I could have. I could have. And it's cooler. It's better over there.
Yeah, this is cooler.
Mm. Mm. Mm.
I was offered this wine. I was offered, proposed. I want to taste it. So they gave me a sample. I opened the bottle, served the glass. Well, it's good. Very austere, but good. It was nice. So I was happy and said, well, I will have it. I said, well, I will taste tomorrow. So I have the bottle here. I put it here. And the day after, I said, well, let's see how it evolved after a day. It changed a little. Well, and I corked it, put it here, and I forgot it. I didn't offer to the people who... I forgot it, and it was in July, it was hot, and 10 days after, I was doing things, I said, oh my goodness, what is it? Oh, I forgot it. Oh, I'm so stupid. I was about to go to the dustbin and say, well, I don't know, let's smell. Oh, it smells good, so let's taste. It was absolutely incredible. Absolutely incredible. 10 days. And I'm very sensitive to oxidization. Or oxidation, excuse me. Oxidation. And it was not oxidized. It was absolutely blossoming. It's the first time in my life that I can drink a wine with 10 days opening and be very good and completely different. That's incredible.
Very seldom.
Yeah. But I can't say to people, open it, drink a glass, wait 10 days, and drink it again.
Open in our house.
It would be a bit difficult. But I'm glad to share my experience. And you can see that even young, it's good. It's full-bodied. Oh, we're gonna taste a lovely wine. One of the stars in Provence. It's a Chateau Lacoste. You have the first wine you tasted was this one, Premier. And this is a great wine from Chateau Lacoste, which is mainly based on Cabernet Sauvignon. But the man who makes the wine is a kind of genius. His name is Mathieu Cosse. He's absolutely fascinating. He knows so well about the soil, about the grapes, about the winemaking. He's absolutely, well, he's a great guy in the world of wine, and the thing he achieves here is really impressive, very complex. That's why I've opened it. But, I won't speak anymore. Taste it. So to make this wine, I've selected plots in the domain. And they just do it. It's made from biodynamic too. So no pesticides, nothing like this. Pure wine.
What is the grape?
45% Cabernet Sauvignon, 30% Syrah, and 25% Grenache.
It's a little bit Syrah.
But,
Where was this?
Next to La Sainte Victoire.
Okay. It's on the behind the Sainte
Victoire. No, the Puy Saint-Réparade.
Okay.
North on the top.
Yes. Okay. Yes. So.
It's in the Bouches du Rhône, not with no more in the Var.
Okay.
No.
This wine you also sell?
Sorry?
You sell all the wines. You have
not this one.
Okay. It was very good this.
This one is nice.
Very spicy.
Yeah.
Very, very nice color also.
Yes.
I like the color.
When you make it on your glass, you see how fat it is.
Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's what we call the legs, les jambes.
Yeah.
And in fact, it's glycerol. It's chemical process. But it always shows a wine with concentration and good balance. Always.
Yeah. Always a good sign.
Yes. Yeah. I think the Chateau Lacoste is not as fascinating as the Beaumont, the pure ceramic today. But it will go further. It will be better when aging than the syrup. It's a wine that needs to be salad a little, the Chateau Lacoste.
Well, this is 2011?
Yeah.
So when will it be at its best?
Yeah, I think in 3 years at least. Yeah. And then can age a lot. So there are not great winemakers in the area. There are good teams. To understand Provence, you have to see who owns the domains. Some domains are owned by families, but usually these families achieve well correct wine. They're not very, they have no exigence. Not a great one. They want to make good, but they say, well, we do what we can, and so on. So, that's a big part of the domain. The other part of the domain are owned by people who invest, because when they buy a domain, they buy 50 hectares, and 10 years after, they can sell it much higher, because the price of the earth here is doing this. So during this time, the domains can invest in technical process, new cuverie, new barrels and so on, because the people who invest have money. But they're not real wine lovers, in fact. That's the main problem in Provence. They don't have the patience for wines. Some have, yes. But very few, in fact. And so, people should see that Cabernet Sauvignon is not the top. It's good, but it's not the top. But they don't dare change it, because they have they make rosé most of the time. Rosé is selling well. I say, okay, let's see, wait and see. So that's the main problem with Provence, the way that people have the domain, the owners. These two typical owners I've just described are 98% of the production. And so only very few there doing something different. For instance, and he's a young winemaker, a young owner, and so on. So he tries. He's got a real passion for wine, and he can take risks, sometimes a big risk, but because he's a wine lover. But he's a bit crazy. He shouldn't do that.
But you mentioned Miraval, the change from playback to 2013. It was Cabernet, and now it's not. It's Cinsault.
No more Cabernet.
Yeah, so they have changed.
Yes, because they want to do the best wine possible.
Yeah.
Brad Pitt said, yes, I agree with you, let's try to make the best possible.
But then you need the funds, because you're really taking out part of your production for 4 years, like you said.
Yeah, but you're always a winner in the medium long term, because you sell with higher price, you've got big, big fame and so on. So it's good, but there's a while during which it can be difficult. But if you're sure of what you're saying, if you're pure, and you make very good, it's evident. You don't have to wait for 10 years before being recognized. If you make very good and make it's easy for professional to see it immediately. Mm-hmm. And we are all trying to find this kind of people. Mm-hmm. But the problem is that most of the production is sold with ordinary channels. And, well, that's problems. So we're going to finish with, it's a part of Provence, but it's not called the Provence or something like this. It's a bundle, a bundle from the same man who made this, du Péré Barrera. And it's 100% Mourvèdre, which is forbidden. You have to have at least 50% Mourvèdre in your blend, but you have to have something, a little part of something else. So I think he took a part of Sanso, a grape, that he put in the barrels. That's it. Well, it's 100% Mourvèdre. And you see the way he vinifies. 4 years ago, or 5 years ago, in fact, he's also a negotiator. So he wanted to make a Châteauneuf du Pape because he loved it. And he made an agreement with the guy saying, I want to have this amount of Châteauneuf du Pape. So he cultivated the vines and he picked a vinifier. And he had 100% by Parker.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Right? Yeah. 100%
Merlot. Oh, yes, but this is IGP. Oh. That's a French law, that's so complicated. The highest appellation is AOC. COA, Controlled Origin Appellation.
Yeah.
AOC in French. And to have this, you have to respect all the things. And if you don't, you can't have COA. So if you want to have COA and Bandol is a COA, you have to respect it. So you have to say, well, it's a blend of Mourvèdre and something different.
Second
time. Excuse me.
How many percent is one grape in a whole barrel?
He's trying to work it out. It was 0.000.
You have to put that on the label.
Yes.
And on the label it's written, mainly from Mourvèdre.
Very clever.
Yeah. And unfiltered.
Unfiltered, okay.
Issued from a exceptional terroir.
Where does it say
COA? It's AOC
only. It's origin control. COA.
He's trans.
Indication géographique protégée.
But he's translating it to English actually, and he's doing it the other way around.
It is AOC.
It's AOC. And he's trying to.
Indication géographique protégée. EIGP. PGI.
Right.
Is there a bit of
salt in
nose?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, it's okay. Oh, it's not okay. Now it's okay.
Mm-hmm. Different, eh?
This is the same winemaker as did the...
the Sanso.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm.
So now I hope that you have got a good thing in your mind to next time you taste other wines, you can remember all the things we've tasted for different prices, but nothing is really expensive, you know. And you will find some cuvées which are sometimes very expensive here or there. And remember what you some of the best that you could taste. It's, well, that's what I would like you to remember with this masterclass. We didn't discuss a lot about the aromas, where sometimes we did it, but it was not that important. So I just wanted to show you some of the best experimentation in the red wine from Provence. And you could see with another one that we've just tasted, and I didn't know it, so I discovered it, like you. And immediately you see the difference with the very interesting things and the other one. So there are many red wines made in the area. Very few are really interesting. The most important thing when you taste the wine is the balance, you know, the general feeling and the balance in the wine. So always try to find wines which are balanced. Of course, they can have something a bit special, a little more of this, but a wine can't be good if it has an excess of this.